Let's continue our course. Today I want to speak about connections. Connection is just some synonym, в общем. Yes? Okay. Yes. Connection is a synonym for covariant derivative. In Riemannian geometry, the most well-known connection is Levi-Civita connection. It is unique and it is well defined on every Riemannian manifold. So you might think about this derivative as a derivative that uses some metrical structure on your manifold. So, for example, there is a Lie derivative on every manifold. There are connections between these derivatives, Lie derivative and Levi-Civita connection. But Levi-Civita is, it depends on a metrical structure of your manifold. Lie derivative, for example, is defined on every smooth manifold, and it is doesn't involve any metrical tensors and so on. So let T with indices I1, IP, J1, JQ will be a tensor of PQ type on Rn. So it means it depends on coordinates x1 and xn. Then suppose that here on this Rn there is some different coordinate system. For example, Z, and the map that goes from these coordinates to that coordinates is affine. It means that this formula is hold. So the dependence between X and Z is affine. It multiplied you, well, it is easy, yes? So you multiply X by matrix and shift it so on the vector B. Then, this is a theorem, but, very simple. Then this object here have comma, and for example k, this is just standard partial derivative of this tensor along k case coordinate. So then this object, you see that here we have one more index below. This object is p key plus one tensor. So the statement of the theorem is that the standard partial derivative, of course, in a flat space, is a tensor of p q plus one type. So this is true, of course, for every situation. But let us suppose that actually we have a vector. So our tensor is just a vector. And so we know that in u coordinates, if we have a vector from the last one lecture, we know that if it is a tensor, then this new components in your coordinate system should be the following: dz I x j. So yeah, this is from last one lecture. So let us calculate this. This is just you see, yes, that if we consider this t tilde and consider this dot k, we should differentiate along new coordinates, along those coordinates in which this in which you consider these components with tilde. Yes, so this tilde components is components in coordinates z. So we consider so this is this, not x. Yeah, it is easy. So then we put it here, then we put here this equation, and what we will get is the following. So it is very easy to interchange z and x and all these indices. It is not very hard to check, but still. So this is the first summand in that sum, and the next summand is the following. I'll put it here. Dx L over dzk tj, and the second partial derivative xj xl. So I j l l k. So here we have summation under the L and J. This is double summation here, and this indices, they are blind. So we see that the good summand is this one. The bad summand is that one. Yes. And
There's a e power dx, какой-то будет.
The...
Вот.
Вот это? J, L, K, L, L, K, I, J.
J.
J, this is J. So here we have only two blind indices, I and K, and all other indexes should be goes by pair, yes, because of summation. So you can guess that if you don't see some letter on the blackboard, this is L and this is L, then this is must be J. Okay, you see that this is exactly the formula for the 1-1 type tensor. Yes, if you consider this is tensor and that is tensor, then only the formula that should be hold, it should be this equals that without this second summand. Yes, because this is just a rule. How does tensors change its components in different coordinate systems? But we have this summand, and we see that exactly here we have the second derivative of z by x. Yes, and it is easy to see that this is zero exactly in the case when z is just depends on x linearly or just, yes, you see, yes, this is just second derivative. It is easy to see that only in this case this is zero. So the theorem is proved. It is very simple. So only in the case when your coordinates change in by affine map, this is standard name for affine maps. Yes, if you don't know, for example, x equals ax plus b. So linear part plus some shift. Only in this case that object, which is just simple partial derivative of our tensor, is a tensor too. Okay. This is the first statement. The second one. Consider this so-called gradient. Actually, it's not a gradient, but just to call this somehow. And here we will put a comma with a dot. So this is comma with a dot, and this is J. First, we will define this object also as a just simple partial derivative along coordinate x, j's coordinate x. So we just defined this, and in the statement is the following. In any another coordinates z, this uh, new object, which is gradient, this dot and a comma, you satisfy the following formula. So it will be also Z plus Christoffel symbols. This should be K, yes. So if in one coordinate system you define these objects just like a simple partial derivative, then in any another coordinate system it will be not simple partial derivative but partial derivative plus some shift. Yes, you can consider all this formula right hand side of this as a differential operator, yes, of the first order. So you here you have only the derivative, yes, this is the first order differential operator, but here you have just plus zero term, yeah, zero term in the sense of derivatives. So it is simple. So in another coordinates this linear part should be shifted by some another additional summand, and this additional summand is exactly the so-called Christoffel symbols. Here, for now, this is this when we don't have metric yet. It is the following. Yes, minus.
This gradient is negative, you mean to say?
Once again.
Gradient is negative, you mean to say? If you consider it as a gradient term.
Yeah. Well, but it is... You don't like this.
Yeah. It shows the direction. No, I mean, is it decreasing or increasing? It's negative or positive?
Mm.
It is negative or positive?
Yeah, there is some. Well, you see that this minus is true. Yes. Maybe you meant that, for example...
Physical terms, if you take acceleration, suppose.
Okay.
If one frame of reference, you can say it is accelerating.
Mm.
Another frame of reference.
No. You don't think. You mean this is not what I want to show. Okay. Let me explain. So. You asking about that, for example, if you have a function, yes, and the gradient should be the direction where it is growing, yes. Actually, I didn't check this. Of course, you can consider a scalar function, yes, here, and consider this gradient. And actually, I can't answer this. Probably this is the right one, I hope. So, T tilde I J is, so this is more or less all these formulas that about differentiating this complex function. Nothing else. Okay. First, let us understand why this is true. Yes? Why is this is true? This is true because actually what do we have? We have that T tilde I J, because it was defined as just a partial derivative. In the previous statement, we proved that this is a tensor. So it means that it is change its components by that formula. Yes? X, Q, Z, J. Yes, this is true because this is tensor. And this is tensor because dot and comma is just the same in these coordinates as a simple partial derivative. But this dot and comma is also partial derivative, and when you will write this down, then you will have here dtp over dxq, yes, this is xq, and this xq will cancel this one. So, and what is left only that multiplier, it is here, yes? So, this zj goes to here, this is one, yes? And this, well, you see, yes, because okay, because actually this t without tilde, actually this is a tensor in coordinates x, and actually you should write here x, yes, but because of this you just cancel out this multiplier, and only that remains, and here you go instead of x, z. So this is easy. Next. It is tilde I dzj. So here we have tilde, and because it is tilde, we should write this. It is also easy because if you just put this summand on the left hand side, then you will have plus here, yes, and this is a standard formula for t tilde, yes. In the left hand side will be only t and t, and this is some standard Leibniz rule. Okay, so exactly what we have now, yes, it is easy, and what we have, this standard derivative of t tilde I over z j, minus t p multiplied by this term I x p x q and d x q pardon x q d z j d z what yes DZJ. This ZJ is this one. So this is the second derivative of that one. Yes, this is X. X. And actually to get the right formula from here. Yes, so here we have XX. No, what is that? Yes, here we have xx, and to get the right formula, we should do what? And pq, q, wait a minute. Here there should be some mistake. This should be one z here. Dzi over dzj is over pq, and here we have
z.
J. Oh, yes. Also, what I should... Yes, yes, yes. Because here we have t without tilde. Yes? Here we have t without tilde, this t. And what also is true? Also is through the following formula, that t tilde I is this, because this is, yes, because t itself is a tensor, so also this is true. So you should put here, instead of t p, t p tilde, and inverse this matrix here, yes, and exactly we'll get this one. So this is this, and this is this. So actually this is just some standard formulas to calculate these derivatives. Okay, so we see that if some tensor in one coordinate system changes, so this is one tensor, if it's changed like a partial derivative in some coordinate system X, then in another coordinate system it will change not like only the derivative, but derivative plus some shift. Okay. Okay. Another theorem. So now we want to ask the question. So we define some these symbols. We call it Christoffel symbols. So and there was a formula for them. We want to ask if these symbols, yes, gamma I, j, k, is a tensor 2 or not. So this object, these symbols, can be a tensor or it can not be a tensor. So the following statement is gives the formula of how does this Christoffel symbols change itself from when you go from one system to another, and actually it proves that the Christoffel symbols itself actually that they don't form tensor. So this is Z J plus gamma I K J tilde T K tilde in Z coordinates. And we want to understand how does these symbols and these symbols, how does they connect it with each other. So this formula for Christoffel symbols is the following. So actually it is not surprising that it is not a tensor also, because so this is a good summand and this is a bad. We see that because of this summand, the Christoffel symbols they do not form a tensor, so the components is not a tensor. Well, I don't know. Probably yes. So everybody write this down who wanted to. Then will be some big calculations. Okay. So what should we do? Actually, we should make these double calculations. We should write this down, these components of this 1-1 tensor, firstly in the tilde notations, tilded notations, and then go back, and there will be the connection between gamma tilde and gamma without tilde. Zp, zq, xj t tilde p dot comma k, then because this is satisfies the second formula from the statement of our theorem, then we put down here, well, I just erase, instead of t tilde we write down this formula, zq plus gamma tilde psq t tilde s. So this is the formula from the statement of the theorem for t tilde. Then we just open some brackets and goes from tilded symbols, tilded t and till here and here to untilded. So here will be the same. I don't want to write this down every time. It'll be alpha. So what we have here, we have dxi, this is from here, over dzp, dzq over dxj. Then from here we have this open brackets here, and what we have dzp over dxk multiplied by dtk over dzq. So this is okay. This is good term. Here we have dxi. This is from here. Dzp. Dzq. Dxj, this is the same, multiplied by the second derivative of d of zp by dzq. This is from here, dxk. Then tk, I want to make it out. Plus gamma tilded sqp, and the same term that was there. So actually dxi dzp dzq dxj multiplied it by this dzs dxk, and here we have dk. So this is actually is what? This is actually is d t I over d x j plus gamma I j k t j. Yes, so there is no k, because summation over k, here we have i and j. So, and actually this is that. So more or less this is all, but you see that here we have this multiplication, here it is all okay, here we have P and P summation, S and Q summation, it is okay, unless what we have here. We can write here down what we can write down here. Instead of this, we can write down dzp over dx, for example, L dxk multiplied by dxl over dzq. And this and that, when you multiply this by that, they cancel each other, yes, because when you multiply this by that, you get a Kronecker symbol. This is actually the identity matrix. So this is these calculations prove that formula from the theorem. And the main consequence of this is just that the Christoffel symbols, they are not a tensor, so they don't form a tensor on your manifold. What does it mean? For example, if your object in one coordinate system is everywhere zero on your manifold, what will it mean? If you consider, you consider some object, yes? You find some coordinate system that such that in every point on your manifold, this object is zero at every point. Yes, for example, a vector field. Yes, and you know that this object was a tensor. What will it mean? It will mean that in any other different coordinate system, this object also will be a zero. You see, yes, because when you have a tensor, it changes only, roughly speaking, linearly. You don't have some additional summand, yes, that can destroy this vanishing. So if you in one coordinate system you have everywhere zero tensor, then in any another it will be zero too. It is important. And these Christoffel symbols they are not tensor. It means, for example, you can consider a Euclidean space, yes, with a standard Euclidean metric, which is everywhere is a constant everywhere. Then in these coordinates, for example, you consider Rn with coordinates x1, xn, yes? And metric or the first quadratic form or metrical tensor is the following. Actually, it can be some symmetrical positively defined matrix that depends on coordinates x1, xn, yes? In any point, it can be different, actually. But you consider the standard Euclidean space from a school, yeah? With a standard Euclidean metric. So what it will mean when the components of your metric is constant for Christoffel symbols? What will they be? No. Do you remember this formula? 1/2 GKL DIL over DUJ plus and so on. Yes? So here we have some derivatives of your metric along this coordinates. There should be x in this coordinates, yes? So what will they be, these Christoffel symbols, if we use standard formula from this first part of our lectures? Zero. It will be, all they will be zero, because we have here some derivative over constants, yes? So in this coordinate system, they all are zero, yes? But you can consider another coordinate systems, for example, spherical one. Spherical coordinate systems, x1 is r cos phi 1, cos phi n minus 1, yes? And so on. In this another coordinate systems, this won't be true. So it means that these Christoffel symbols, they depend on the coordinate system. This is what is important. They depend on the coordinate system. If you calculate in one coordinate systems and you get that all of them are zero, it doesn't mean that it will be true in another coordinate system. So, roughly speaking, these components, they are not, they don't have some physical, good physical interpretation, because they depend on a coordinate system. So they are not invariant in this tensorial sense. Should we make a break? Yes, okay. In that time. So he was dropped off from this university, but still, of course, in Soviet times especially, and up until now, this university, it has a name of Lenin. It has University of the Ulyanov Lenin. So you know his real surname was Ulyanov, and Lenin was his pseudonym. Yes. So up until now, this very big university, so it is very big. It has name of the student who was dropped off, actually. Okay, and what about this, what I wanted to emphasize when I talked about this vanishing of the Christoffel symbols? For example, if we calculate curvature using this huge formula from the first part of our course, If it is zero, yes, then it is zero it any coordinate system. For example, you can consider a polar system on your plane. Yes, you can consider Descartes system of coordinates. In any system of coordinates, if it is flat, by flatness I mean that the curvature is zero. If it is flat, then it is flat in any coordinate system. So this entity, a curvature, it does not depends on a coordinate systems, but the Christoffel symbols, they depend. Okay. Oh, good. What? Next. So, by the way, this standard notation from Riemannian geometry is the following. If we have vectors E1, En, usually you can identify them with partial derivatives over the ith coordinate. So they form a basis in a tangent space of your manifold, locally at least. Then this notation usually is used. So here you should see that this index here, this is not the index of the components of vector E, yes? So every eith is a vector. So this is not index in the components of this vector. You have n vectors. So here we put this eith down. Actually, if you want to consider the components of the eith vector, the components of the eith vector is j, yes, and you put index j up. You put it up, and then it will be components. And this is actually this the matrix. So this is for any eith, it is a vector. Then you can see that there's a covariant derivative of eith vector along j coordinate, and you also get some another tangent vector, and the components in these linear combinations, they are exactly the Christoffel symbols. It's just like in differential geometry. Okay. So in differential geometry, here we had a plus second fundamental form multiplied by normal vector, but when you consider some abstract manifold that doesn't emerge in some greater space, yes, then you don't have any normal vector, you have only tangent vectors. Okay. This is just a notation. So what is the consequences of this formula for Christoffel symbols? First, that if the change of your coordinates is affine, it means that the second derivatives A0, then this is a tensor. It is easy. What's next? Also, if you have some suppose you have different Christoffel symbols. Different. I don't want. It doesn't mean that they calculated in different coordinate systems. But suppose that you have one covariant derivative that depends on Christoffel symbols gamma 1. Yes, 1. And another covariant derivative that depends on different Christoffel symbols too. So we put here one and we put here two. But so you have different connections on your manifold. It is in some cases it is possible. Actually, in Riemannian geometry, almost never this it is never happened, because in Riemannian geometry the standard connection is Levi-Civita connection and it is unique. But there is some different generalizations, and actually now it has become very popular to consider different connections with, for example, with some different torsion and so on. So it is actually possible to consider different connection on your manifold. So what is important? If you have different connections, then the difference of its Christoffel symbols is a tensor. Because when you consider the difference of these symbols, you just cancel this bad term and it became a tensor. And the last one and the most useful for us, this symmetrization or not anti-symmetrization, which is usually denoted like that, JK. Yes, it is torsion. And it is tensor. So this difference is a tensor. And this tensor is called torsion, кручение по-русски. And it is a tensor. So it means that if you consider this tensor and you find that in some coordinate system it is zero, then it is zero everywhere. So this is what?
That Einstein-Cartan theory, which postulated that our geometry had non-zero torsion.
Once, еще раз.
Теория Эйнштейна-Картана, когда метрического тензора антисимметричная часть какая-то и.
Я знаю, что есть как бы вот связанности с. Yes, in Cartan he generalized this method. Actually, it is very powerful, and I hope to tell something about that. For example, Cartan method, and in this approach there is torsion. Yes, because this basis it is non-holonomic. And there should be some torsion, but in this different basis the calculations became much more easy. So I think I'll tell something about this. But in standard Riemannian geometry, when these vector fields, the coordinate vector fields, you consider this tensor, and it should be zero. For example, if you consider Levi-Civita connection. Okay. So one more some technical, and sometime it is useful to use these formulas. You can define this covariant derivative not only on the vector fields but on any tensor, and the following Cartan formula will be true. You understand? Yes, this is this long index, multi-index. So minus here, and then we put this index. Oops, it's bad. Okay, L I 2. Oh, pardon. Not I, K2, K3, K, for example, Q, and multiplied by gamma L, K1, yes, from, it should be down, and J is here, yes, okay. So this is the first summand with a minus. Next summand, you should put L here instead of K2, then instead of K3, and so there will be Q summands. I don't want to write them down all. You understand, yes? So instead of K2, you put L here. Here will be K1. So K1, L, K3, etc. And here you will just have K2. So Q summons here, and plus P summons of the upper indices. The first one of them will look like that. P K gamma I, not I, I is bad, I is just M J I 1. Yes, I1 instead of I1 is M. Under M you have summation, M summation. So, and here we have just another P summons of this type. So this is general formula. You can use it, but actually it is almost useless, actually in real calculations you almost never use it. Okay, another feature of this covariant derivative is that it is also respect the Leibniz rule for the tensorial product, and I don't want to put all these indices here. If you will need it, you can find it easily somewhere. Okay. So yes, and and what is important and useful formula that is some concrete case of the previous one is the following formula for the covariant derivative of a metric. It is the following. Okay. This is will be used later. Let us consider some example of a connection in different sense. For example, we can define a connection in a standard way, so partial derivative plus some shift. Yes, alpha is equal to 1, etc. n. Psi is a function that goes from some open area, some open domain in Rn to Rk. So actually this is n over n, oops, k, k over k matrices, yes? You see that this is almost the same, yes? So you have partial derivative of some object plus shift. You see that here you have index alpha, and alpha goes from 1 to n. And actually, for any alpha, this is a k over k matrix, yes? So actually, you can write down here, for example, I. You can write here down L I. Yeah. So one index goes from 1 to n, and to another indices goes from 1 to k. Yes. So actually, these situations, when you put down here gamma, all indices goes the same number. So, this is another connection. What changes of you can consider? So, under these changes, your object should be invariant. Yes, you can change coordinates of x. You just can consider it's just, for example, you have d, yes, this is domain in Rn. Here you have x, and over any point in d you have rk, yes, where it goes. So this is called bundle, locally trivial bundle. So you can change coordinates here, you can change coordinates here. So you can consider different frames, different bases in the, in this space. Also, usually you have some group that acts here. You know what is Lie group. So consider this is some as a some subgroup in group of matrix. Yes, for example, usually it is some kind of rotations. Yes, you know what is orthogonal matrices. Yes, it means that, for example, if you rotate your coordinate systems, everything looks the same. Yes, so the main characters of your psi, yes, which is how do you call that? Observables, yes. So they should not change when you act on them with this rotation group. So what does it mean? It means, so if you rotate this this vector psi, it means that rotation and this covariant derivative should you can interchange them. So there should not be the difference if you consider a covariant derivative and then action of a group, or if you consider an action of a group and then derivative. For example, what I wanted to say that if some g, and this is actually, it means what? That in every fiber, yes, over point x, you have some rotation. Yes, if you consider the different dot from this domain and fiber over it, they also will be rotation, but the different one. So in any fiber over this domain, you have a rotation that depends on this x. Yes. So actually, you have a set of matrices of orthogonal matrices, and each of them they depend on a point x. Yes. And you should consider only those covariant derivatives which are invariant under these rotations. So it means that the multiplying by this group element and the covariant derivative should be commutative. There should not be difference when you multiply in these two operations, covariant derivative and group action. It means what? It means the following. So you rotate your vector, yes, this is k over k vector, this is orthogonal matrix, for example, and this is covariant derivative over all of this. This is also the k vector. This should be this. So this is also k over k vector. This is also the same k over k orthogonal matrix. This should be hold. So this is the most, I think, natural condition for covariant derivative.
This holds good for reflection and translation, only for rotation.
Yes. When you consider some concrete It actually depends on if you want to consider these objects that are invariant under reflections when you change the orientation of the space. It depends on your concrete problem, I think. So, I just put down some trivial theorem. Now, that the I write it down in here, you see, yes, the covariant derivative and the action of the group is they are commutating only in the case when this only in the case when these matrices hold the following identity. And also here you have some analog of the formula for the Christoffel symbols. If you look not very careful for this formula, you see that this is bad summand and this is good one. So this is how does this Christoffel symbols should be changed when if they were tensor, so this is just a conjugation by the group. So you consider only the conjugation by the group element of for your Christoffel symbols. But this is the bad sum, and that's some kind of shift. Yes, and I forgot to say that this should be these matrices. These matrices should be actually yes. So this is the group element that rotates your fiber. Where does this vector psi is defined? But where should be these matrices? Where should be they from? So you define your covariant derivative in the following way. So you have some vector, yes? It depends on coordinates x. You define your covariant derivatives like some partial derivative plus some shift, some linear shift of these vectors. Yes, so you multiply your vector by some matrix. So if this is a derivative of your vector and it is invariant under this G action, where from these matrices should be? So very small, very small shift by this group element, what will it be? So the derivative, this is a very small shift, yeah, along some direction. If your derivative should be invariant under this action of some group, where from should be this vector, this matrices? Huh? I think you know these words that I want you to spell. No. So for any alpha, this matrix should be from Lie algebra of this group, of this Lie group J. You know what is Lie algebra? No? This is bad. So probably, actually this is bad because it is important. So, okay. Geometry. For example, you have group ON. This is N over N orthogonal matrices. This is, so this this space is Rn squared. Yes? And this is submanifold here. What is the dimension of this submanifold?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
N? No, not N. No? No? Actually, we will calculate the dimension of this manifold now. Okay, so what is matrices, orthogonal matrices? This is the matrices that it's transposed is equal to it is inversed. Yes? What for these strange conditions? These strange conditions is for the following thing. If you have some had two vectors u and v and you rotate each of them, then the scalar product of these two vectors and these two vectors will be the same. Yes, it means that just when you write down the scalar product in from the like a matrix, it will be this one. Yes. When you consider that the vector is one n matrix, then this scalar product is exactly the product of these matrices, and it is equal to this one. Yes, it means that this should be identity matrix. Okay. So it is easy to see that identity matrix is orthogonal matrix. It is because identity matrix it do nothing. So you want to, for example, consider some little shift of identity matrix. You consider matrix Q that is equal to, no, I consider matrix A that is equal to identity matrix plus some small shift Q. And I want to understand when does this small shift for which matrix is Q, this small shift of identity matrix will be the orthogonal matrix. Yes? So I should put this to this identity. I will use this one, that this is E. Yes? So yeah? So I write the same. So this is small shift of from the, you had identity point in this space. Yes? This is a point with coordinates, well, this is just a point in this space. And you consider this small shift of identity along the vector the vector q. Q actually it is a matrix, but you shift your identity matrix along this in this direction, in the direction of q. And you want that this shifted identity will be the orthogonal matrix. This is the same. What I wrote down here. What and what is it? This is I plus T. You just open your brackets and what will you get? You get this one. Plus T squared of something. But T is small. You consider only the small shift, only small perturbation of the identity point. And it should be equals to I, yes? It means that this should be zero. What does it mean? It means that we calculated the tangent space over orthogonal matrices. So the small shift, yes, the directions where you shift your identity and you get the orthogonal matrices, this is the directions where you shift. This is exactly the tangent space of your manifold, yes? Well, it is very geometrical picture because you have this point on your manifold, yes? If you will go in this direction, you won't stay in your manifold, yes? If you go in the direction in which you infinitely small stays in your manifold, you exactly get the tangent space of your manifold. So the tangent space in this is identity matrix is a point on your manifold. The tangent space of orthogonal matrices, this is exactly the skew symmetric matrices. Yes? Okay, I'll tell you about this more carefully later. But this is exactly the algebra of this group. So your group was O(n), and the tangent space in the, if you have a group, you always have an identity there. So the tangent space of your group, it is called Lie algebra of your group, and it is denoted with small letters. Usually, if for example, if you have group SUN, then the algebra of this group will denote as SUN with small letters. So this is just annotations. And this is algebra. This is algebra. It means that you have two operations there. In group, you have only multiplication, one operation. In algebra, you have two operations. It means that you can sum your elements of an algebra, but also you can find a multiplication on your algebra, and in this case, in the case of Lie algebra, it is usually the Lie bracket of vector fields. So yes, I will tell about this later, maybe one lecture, because this is important. You see, some physical true situations, they do not depend on some rotations, and it is important to know how does this group, how does it construct, and you know, well. Okay, so just to finish this moment these matrices for any alpha, this matrix should be in the Lie group of in the Lie algebra of Lie group G. So this is denoted as G small. Actually, this is Gothic. Usually, you can see the small Gothic letters in the books.
Small chain should be in the tangent space, not
yes.
Not orthogonal to the
tangent. Yes, yes. I'll talk about this later more concrete. So yes, and if you want to define this covariant derivative, you define it as a summation of a standard partial derivative and this small shift that is invariant under the group action. To be invariant, it should be from Lie algebra. Okay, and then I'll tell you some concrete examples next time. Okay, thanks.